afternoon, everybody. How are you? I'm very pleased to be here with you again, and I've been away for a little bit just to see how much there's going to be response asking for me.
They are looking for you, Padma.
I see the search party was out for me. Well, I hope you've all been well. It's a great pleasure to be here with Mr. Lakhani again for our Hinduism Q&A, weekly Q&A session. And we're here to learn a little bit and understand the questions that come up most commonly, and things that are different from when we were taught this when we were younger. So great pleasure to have you all. Hello, Mr. Lakhani. And we'll jump straight in with our very first question, which I've been reading, and oh my God, so much exciting questions from all of you. You once said that the real human struggle is to get an identity. What did you mean by that?
Yes, you see, this too, in one of my talks, I did mention that really the search that we are all out for is not for a God, but to sort ourselves out. And the most important thing that we have to do is, who the heck are we? That is the main thing. Now, let me just give you a little bit of philosophic background. The way we understand reality is using these kind of words like where, when, how, why. These are standard things that we understand. Whereabouts does it happen? When does it happen? Space and time. How does it happen? Causality, cause and effect. Why does it happen? It's kind of more human way of looking at that, why certain things unfold. But the most important question that we fob off is, what is this? What? Not why, where, when, how, no. What? What is the nature of reality? What is this? Now, every time this question arises, what we do is we kind of fob it off by using a string of words. You know, we say, what is this? Oh, it's called the universe. See, we just invented a word rather than actually explore what is meant by the nature of reality. So the most important question we have to ask ourselves is, what is it? What is the nature of reality? What is our true nature? So the what question is the most difficult. It seems the most easiest because you just kind of produce a string of words to kind of explain it away, but it doesn't do that. So the idea of exploring what is the nature of reality is in fact the key idea. So we're in search of identity. Who the heck are we? What is our true nature? This is the real search of religion rather than search of God. We use God as a ploy to sort ourselves out, if we come to terms with our human condition. So what is this all about? This is the central issue. Now, you see, when we are looking for identity, how do we do it? First of all, we start our journey as animals. And the way we identify ourselves is the body. We say, oh, we are the body must be looked after, you must be fed, you must be looked after, you must be well clothed, well sheltered, etc. So we look after our bodily requirements as the first response to what is our true nature. We are animals, we just human. You are physical beings, and our physical needs have to be taken care of. That's what the animals do. In fact, the apex of this idea comes with Richard Dawkins, because he says, if you ask him, what is all this? He will say, eat, drink, reproduce, and die. See, this is, if you like, the purely and highly materialistic vision of who we are. Just a material being, just meant to be snuffed out, eat, drink, be merry, and reproduce, because that's the whole aim of this alpha and omega of science, and then die. Full stop, you get snuffed out. This is Richard Dawkins' version. Now, then we go into the kind of much more intellectual aspect. Who the heck are we? Then we seem to be identifying ourselves with the body. We say, let's identify ourselves with our mindset. So it might involve saying that, okay, how do I judge what is my mindset? In fact, you may think you are doing it yourself, but in fact, it is not true. It is society that imposes a mindset on you which you subscribe to and kill yourself fulfilling. I'll give an example. You look at any advertisement going on, they'll say, oh, people are on holiday, look, they're smiling all the time. You ask them, are they smiling all the time? Nothing doing. Oh, look at this bed, she's sleeping on the bed, so funny, oh, she's fun. So that actually the commercial forces hijack the idea of what is our identity. They say, that's what you need to be. Bigger car, bigger house, buy this bed, buy this Lexus car, this and that. So they, in effect, they impose an identity on us that we need to kind of subscribe to and kill ourselves trying to fulfill. This is where majority human being stops. But then there's another kind of identity. We say, what is your family, your social, your cultural identity? That's another way we try and address our human condition. So we say, okay, you've got family values. Just they look, you're improving from being animal, just looking after your bodily needs, to just saying, okay, you know, follow the worldly approach to life, saying eat, drink, and, you know, follow this advertisement campaign and buy this and that. The third one is focusing on, say, social and cultural and family values. This is the identity we kind of subscribe to. This is a better way, because you are now, in a way, kind of going higher up the scale from the animal, away from the animal. So looking after greater good of greater humanity, etc., becomes, the identity you are like to kind of subscribe to. What a wonderful idea. So this is how the progress continues. And yet, the final thing is this. in order for us to get identity, we sometimes turn towards religions or spiritual aspects. Okay, here again, be careful, because we easily kind of identify ourselves with what the majority are saying. Suppose you find a movement where there are thousands of people applauding and beating drums, and you've got big organizations. Well, I must belong to that because everybody else belongs to it. This is sheepish mentality. Just act like sheep. Everybody's doing it, so let me subscribe. Fair enough, this is better than perhaps just subscribing to the idea that I'm a material being chasing after material things, like Madonna says. The idea is better to think of higher principles, saying, okay, let me focus on this temple body or this sectarian movement. I agree, this you're improving, you're moving up the scale. But again, you see, you notice that, again, most of these Hindu bodies will either will take you onto a kind of ritualistic path, saying, follow this ritual, go on pilgrimage, go on this jatra, etc. Or they'll say, in that case, why don't you, bow down to this guru, and he has already saved thousands of people, he'll save you, and it's all artificial. But then you might get caught up with that, and you might kind of subscribe to that. The highest, if you like, the best way of understanding who am I comes from ancient as well as modern kind of rishis of India, and the one that I focus on is Ramana Maharshi. When you ask him any spiritual question, he says, just ask yourself, who are you? What is your true nature? We may think we have actually come to terms with it. We have not come to terms with it. We kind of subscribe to certain hypes that has been sold to us, and we kind of subscribe to that. What is our true nature? This is the real stirring up, and this is stirring up in a way reflects our spiritual dimension. So when you're trying to address our own condition, say, who am I? You suddenly find that, okay, you are full of desires, and they don't stop. And as Buddha discovered, and as the ancient Hindus discovered, the way to really find your identity is to rise above the desires that are clouding your worldview. We are all caught up with this. And as Buddha says, really, you know, you are saying, okay, I'm trying to fulfill my desires. Who is this my? Just a flux, has no identity at all. You just give it an identity, and you're trying to fulfill the desires of that kind of flux. So you're kind of in a very kind of shaky ground. Rise above desires, says Buddhism. Same thing says Hinduism. Rise above desires to discover your true identity, because the desires cloud your vision regarding who you truly are. And this is not merely intellectual exercise. It has to be experiential to come to fruition. My friend, religion begins when you say, I want to experience this thing. What is my true nature? I don't believe in it or read about it in the book. I want to experience it for myself. Real religion begins.
No, but it hits home to a lot of people who are actually very high in the social scale. So people who are barristers and people learned from Cambridge and Oxford and the biggest institutes there are in the world, they actually find a time in their life when they go and say, I went off and left everything to find myself. True. And I've heard that so many times from so many people who say, I've just gone to find myself. And they've left a £1 billion home, their family and everything, just to go and live out in the woods and live with at one with nature to understand what they are.
Padma, these are truly spiritual beings and rediscover their spiritual foundation. These are wonderful people throughout the world, and we do find them all over the place.
Yes, and you're quite right about where, you know, people kill themselves, beat themselves up to meet a certain criteria or standard set up by the environment. There was one gentleman I'm adding more to the question here, more to the answer here. There was a gentleman in Long Island on the brink of bankruptcy, but he couldn't mow his own lawn because the neighbors didn't mow their own lawn.
So
you had to have a gardener to come and do it and pay the gardener with money that he didn't have. He eventually lost the house.
You basically live for a hype and you finally destroy yourself.
Yes. Anyway, so friends, if you like that, please do like, share, comment, and invite your friends. And if you happen to be watching this on YouTube, do make sure that you hit the bell button and you also subscribe. So if you hit the bell button, the advantage is that the next time we upload something wonderful like this, you'll be informed about it. Okay, so Mr. Lakhani, we have the second question. Mr. What is the cause of all the violence in the world we see? Is there a way to end it? I think that's a $64 million question, if there was some way of doing it. But I'm sure there's some sort of answer you could give to this.
This is from Mr. Relwani that I know personally. So it's a lovely question to explore. Look, when you really examine all the kind of violence that is taking place on the world stage today, you'll find two motivations. One is either purely power play, commercial interests. This is one of the greatest, if you like, driving force for violence. For example, very frank, say in the Middle East, the reason why there's so much attention given to the Middle East and all so much fighting is because there is oil. So all the major powers are very keen to grab, if you like, a piece of this cake. So that is why they create violence, because they are just trying to get a piece of the cake. This is one reason. So it's got strong political motivation or strong commercial motivation at the back of the political motivation that drives, creates a lot of tension and war. So the way to do, you know, way to get around that would simply be, see, people said, Mr. Lakhani, you talk about the caste system in India in the villages, the potter's son is a potter, it's a horrible thing. I say, my friend, actually the caste is now no longer restricted to some little villages and village people. It has become international. You'll be surprised what I'm saying next. I'm saying there is a caste. What does a hierarchical caste mean? It means there is one group of people who are trying to control the other people and live off their sweat and blood. This is what hierarchical caste is. Real nasty piece. Now, you may think this is visible in some Indian, you know, village, etc. In reality, it's visible worldwide. It's become international. I tell you the example. You got the first world and the third world. Just look at the history of humanity. In the last 200 years, the European culture, European civilization went out of its way to capture, control other part of the world. They really divided the whole world. Australia, New Zealand, North America, South America, most of East Africa, Africa. No, they really divided up all the rest of the world and little pieces of cake that they can kind of eat and squeeze money out, take away the resources. This is the first world using their economic muscle to squeeze life and blood out of the third world. Here is your caste system. Same issue, except now it's internationalized. The first world squeezing. This is why the poor nations, because they don't have economic muscle, they can't fight against it. They are at the mercy of these commercial powers and say, oh, come on, we're going to buy your coffee at this price, your bananas at this price. You sell it, otherwise you die. So the poor people, the third world is the significance of the caste on a worldwide scale. First world ruling and living of the skin, you know, of the lifeblood of the third world. Reality, isn't it? Whether it is resources you pinch at a low price, or whether we pinch their, if you like, the human resources, the human power to buy cheap material from them, get cheap material to produce in a cheap way. This is the real caste visible. This is one of the reasons why we have violence in the name of religion. It is, if you like, this kind of very strongly colonial approach in dealing with world affairs. That's one. The second reason why we have violence or problem in the name of on the world stage is in the name of religion. You may be surprised. Now, the reason behind it is very simple. The three Abrahamic traditions are exclusivist by nature. I'm telling you, they cannot tolerate this idea of more kind of pluralistic approach that comes from the Indic religion. They just can't stand it. I'll give you my example. I was a director of Religious Education Council of England and Wales for many years, and I was trying to push in the idea of pluralism, many ways to be spiritual, not just one way, not just Christ, not that we are chosen people, but, you know, with a special covenant with God. I was fighting this all the time, and do you think the Christian or the Jewish lobby were prepared to listen to me? Nothing doing. They said, Mr. Lakhani, stop using the word pluralism. Exclusivism is the name of the game. This causes violence in the name of religion, because exclusivism doesn't mean just I'm right and you're wrong. Within the same religion, you'll have a division again. Haven't you seen in Northern Ireland Protestants killing the Catholics and Catholics blowing up the Protestants for so many years? So even in this, exclusivism doesn't stop with just one religion. It subdivides the same religion. So within the same religion, people are blowing each other up. So the idea of exclusivism has to be taken out like a thorn in the side of all religions and incorporate and in a way embrace the idea of pluralism that comes at the heart of Hindu tradition. I'm pumping it in, and I tell you, I was struggling at the Religious Education Council. I'm saying put this on air because they were not prepared to listen. Therefore, this is a, you know, weird thing, Mr. Lakhani. This is the resolution, the prescription of how people of many different religions or even people in the same religion can coexist with each other with dignity and full flow without any problem. This is your way, this is my way. I won't impose my way on you. This is your way, suits your temperament, good for it. Progress, my friend. If we incorporate, first recognize this first world, third world division and people in power and position trying to squeeze money out of, squeeze resources out of poor people, that will stop one form of violence. The second form of violence is stopped by recognizing pluralism, many ways to be spiritual. Once you embrace that idea, the Abrahamic tradition, violence in the name of religion will stop instantly. This is my promise. But they won't do it. I was struggling to put, in fact, I managed to put in the word pluralism into the religious education syllabus by just really shoving it in. With tremendous resistance from, you'll be surprised, from the Jewish and the Christian lobbies.
You know, there is no religion that teaches violence.
But see, this is how it unfolds on the world stage.
Not a single religion in the world, not one religion in the world that says violence is an answer to anything. True. Not a single one. Namaste Jay Bhai, one question here. What are your views on prayers? Are those really getting heard, responded somewhere inside or outside in both the cases, whether one is a believer of duality or non-duality?
You've rolled in so many issues and there's just one question, but so be it. You know, first of all, prayers. Now, you see, the thing is this. When you are under duress, we all come under different stages in our life. We come under duress. We come under severe pressure and we need to kind of reach out because we feel we don't have the power to respond or to kind of resolve our human condition. So we kind of reach out. Nothing wrong. In fact, you know, Krishna's definition of the devotees is as follows. Interesting in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, I've got four kinds of devotees. The first kind of devotees are those who are in duress, really struggling. So they're going to reach out to me and say, Lord, help me. Help me. I can't handle it anymore. The one first kind of devotees in duress. Krishna says, fine, I listen to them. The second kind of devotees, says Krishna, it's interesting to explore this in the Bhagavad Gita, are those who are basically artharthi, is the Sanskrit word, means who are out for something. This is, Lord, we will do this prayer for you, we'll do this jatra if you make sure my son gets a wife. Now, you see, this is doing commerce with God. And Krishna says, if you want to do business with me, you're doing with other people, you want to do it with me, do it. I'll play along. So these are the second kind of devotees, artharthi, means trying to get something out of God or idea of God. And you see, the thing is this, we must smile, Pradma. In the Hindi films, or even the serials, they use God as the fourth emergency service. Have you noticed? It's frightening.
Yes.
So first, ambulance, police, fire brigade. But then if all fail, then Mataji, my son is in operating theater, please sort him out. I see, this is you're misusing God. This is not fair. But this is the third, this is the second artharthi. For the purpose they will pray or worship, fair enough. Krishna says, no problem, come for it. Then the third kind of devotee, says Krishna, are very interesting. He says, are Jignasu, the Sanskrit word. That means, in English, the root word is nosy parkers. They're saying, is there God real?
Inquisitive.
Are you for real? They're good in a way, but they're kind of nosy. Are you for real, God? So they're kind of just inquiring. They're not the inquisitive, as you said. So this is a third form of devotee. Krishna, no problem, you can inquire about me and I'll see what I can do. But the fourth form of devotee, this is what I would like to respond to in this question. The fourth form of devotee, says Krishna, are the closest to me. The reason is they love me not because they want something from me, not because they're in duress, not because they're inquisitive. They just can't help themselves. Can you believe that? These are the true devotees. There's a lovely story in the Mahabharata where, Yudhishthir and the five brothers are struggling and Draupadi, their wife, is fed up. And every morning Yudhishthir gets up and prays to God. And Draupadi says, what has he done for us? Look at us, we are in tatters and we no food, nothing. And you keep praying to God, what has he done for us? And Yudhishthir gave a beautiful reply. These are the real devotees. He said, look, O queen, can you see we are at the bottom of the Himalayas, the beautiful Himalayan chain? The Himalayan chain does nothing for me, but the beauty, the grandeur steals my heart, so I can't help but fall in love with it. There's nothing happening. These are the true devotees. They are called Parapakta. Means they are in love with God because they can't help themselves. This is a true sign of devotion. So, if example, your love is for some purpose, some duress, fair enough, says the Lord, that's acceptable. So how is he responded? According to the Hindu, according to me, this is much more philosophic aspect, the real help comes from within you. But the fact that you kind of, in a way, prompted it or plonked it on God allows you to give it this kind of free flow, allows you to give it expression. So the fact that you plonk on God, say, oh Lord, I'm in difficulty, I've got this problem, sort it out. That particular force that you have within you is kind of awakened by this particular prayer. So the real help comes not from outside God, say, hello, yahoo, I'll sort you out. It comes from within you. Remember that, my friend, you have it an infinite potential. It's just that you don't know that. And by using prayers, you are, in a way, invoking the potential you already have to resolve your issue.
So this is a theme that you've been reinforcing right from the start, which is that you have the solutions all inside you. And in fact, when you do coaching skills, coaching is part of where you are taught to look for the answers within yourself because you have the capacity to do it. But you don't know how to recognize it.
See, Padma comes with all these professional words.
So coaching relies on this
principle. Missed that. We missed all these tips.
So we have a very lovely question from Bibhavari Bandyopadhyay. Please do excuse me if I say the name wrong. Is there any historical proof for all the god and goddesses like Shiv, Krishna, Saraswati and Lakshmi or mentioned in our religious books?
Okay.
If at all these images are man-made, then why do we worship them?
Okay, Vibhavari, that I think the right pronunciation. It's a beautiful question. Look, this is where the Hindus really fall short and get into trouble. All these colorful images you have, gods and goddesses, you've got so many millions, is, if you like, man-made. We have made them. We, in a way, they kind of aspirations and say, okay, I want knowledge. So I kind of, you know, put this aspiration on the image of Saraswati. So if I want to be, you know, very, very strong, I put this idea of Mother Goddess as Shakti or as Hanuman, giving power, empowering humanity. So these are my aspirations. And I, in order for me to relate to them, I never project them outward and create the imagery that would suit that particular objective. So Saraswati is holding a Veena like that. So it's a, this is the mother of knowledge and music and knowledge, etc. So we in a way are in a way extrapolating our own aspirations by giving certain imagery. That's why we got so many different imagery of so many thousands of gods and goddesses. But you say, why should we bother? If it's man-made, why should we bother to worship them? Look, in a way projecting your aspiration outward, it is easy to build relationship with it. Suppose it is inside, oh, I've got aspiration to be knowledgeable. See, it stays, it kind of gets stifled. But when you prompt it outside, you know, project it outward, then you can build relationship. Oh, I want to worship. I would go to the Saraswati Sloka by heart. I can recite it and keep repeating in the morning and I'll become clever. So in a way, by giving expression, don't be kind of apologetic about expression. Look, I'll tell you how powerful. And don't underestimate them, undermine them. The same is happening in science. You may be very surprised. Science is doing exactly the same thing. So when you talk about atom, electron, proton, you think, wow, this is reality. There's no such thing. It's a ploy we use to make sense of the physical world we encounter. Do you know that? All these are just mental modes. There are no point particles. It'll explode. You can't have a point particle. Yet we create them so that we can then build our model on it. We can produce the crystallography and, you know, get all these lovely, wonderful gizmos. But in a way, plonking the idea of the nature of reality, it is symbolic, it is purely kind of idealistic, it is not real, and yet we do it because it allows us to get better grasp of reality and help produce all these gizmos we are using. So science too does that. So if somebody says, Hindus, you're horrible, why would you say Saraswati is like these four arms and all that? This is our aspiration. In order for us to build relation with the aspiration, we produce them in this image and we still worship them. Nothing to be fearful about. This is the beauty of this tradition. We're not apologetic about all this colorful imagery. Man-made, so be it.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. I think a lot of scientists might be a little bit perturbed by
they are beginning to realize it. And I'm shoving them big time.
Institute of Physics has just crumbled.
No, they are going to come after me, but I'm ready for them. Especially Richard Dawkins.
All right. Okay. So we have a lovely question from Dr. Anoop Kenthola. It is said that due to the ignorance only, we are struck in this Mahamaya. If true, then who is ignorant? If I am the Atma, Brahman, can Atma be ignorant of itself? Kindly include the question.
Okay, it's a good question. It's a very philosophic one. I'll give a short answer simply because if I try to give a long-winded answer, most of the viewers will switch me off. So I can't risk that. I'm being apologetic about that. The answer is this. Atman and Brahman, now what is all this about? In reality, how do we make sense of the world and what is the idea of knowledge and ignorance? You see, I see the world in front of me. I see it as an objective reality. Now, I'm the subject, I'm observing this. And this is a type of intermediary. I've got some things, my senses are giving me experience of what this world is all about. So I'm using those senses to make sense of the world. So I got subject, object, and intermediary, trying to give, kind of link up me up with the subject, the objective world. In fact, this is how we operate at normal, you know, human level. Now, when you talk about Atman and Brahman, something dramatic happens. This is why it is something that can only be verified, not through intellectual gymnastics, but through first an encounter. It's the only way you can understand the meaning of the word Atman and Brahman. So this is what happens. The subject-object divide that we are kind of fixated on in our normal routine life, that disappears. So when you've got subject-object divide and intermediary, you can have idea of ignorance and knowledge. I'm using my senses to make sense of the world, or I'm ignorant about the knowledge being passed on by the five senses. The word ignorance, etc., appears in this worldly manner when you're making sense subject-object with intermediary. When you realize your true nature as Atman or Brahman, this subject-object and intermediary disappears. They all merge. There's nothing. So the experience, this is not intellectual, experiential Hinduism. When you experience Atman and Brahman, the idea that you have at any time Atman was ignorant of himself doesn't appear even. The question doesn't appear. it is such a dynamic, fast an encounter. Just imagine subject object division goes. First you see something, spirit, as an external thing that you are kind of experiencing, and in no time you know you are that. This is the whole teaching of Vedas. This idea that aham brahmasmi, my true nature is Brahman, and there is intermediary and I'm not knowledgeable, all this fall on the wayside. So it's a bit philosophic, but I had to touch it.
Wonderful, thank you. So friends, please do like, share and invite your friends to join us on this wonderful occasion. And if you are watching on YouTube, please do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell button so that you can be informed of any new videos that we upload. We have a welcome to Karthik Ji, Devarun, Urmila Sharma and Paras Thakur. Welcome to have you on board. So Karthik Shetty, Bangalore, India has a question for you. Oh, we have more viewers. Mr. Sanks Peparia, Ravindra Patel, Uma Velu, Anil Nai, Urmila Sharma, Valand. Welcome. And it's very great, good to have you all here. So like, share and invite all your friends and to join us. Devarun has given us a question. I believe in reincarnation of the soul. If moksha is ultimate nature of the soul, is it feasible that one day all of humanity will vanish as everyone reaches moksha? Oh, that's an interesting question.
In fact, look, this is the promise of Hindus. This friend of right, you know, very interesting thing. They're saying sometimes some people are taking a very scenic route to achieve moksha, or kind of realize that the world they were kind of chasing after is a delusion and they rise above it. But it takes sometimes a very long time, a lot of thumping before you recognize it. That's called moksha, rise above the idea, limited idea you have regarding who you are. This is moksha. Now, this is the beautiful promise of Hindus, is that even if you're a horrible, villainous person, nasty fellow, real yucky fellow in, you know, grandfather's language, even then, you are destined for moksha. This is the Hindu promise. So there is no, this is your destination, this is your true nature, rediscovering your true, it's not you're inventing your nature, it is there. It's just kind of, you take a scenic route, why are you in a rush? You run around, scenic route. Let me tell a funny story. I like to do stories like this, otherwise it becomes too heavy and philosophic. This is a story, of course, from the Puran, but they sometimes contain very interesting philosophic ideas. Narada was wondering about, of course, he visits Vishnu regularly and has got a kind of regular pass to visit Vishnu, Vaikut, and he's walking around and he sees one man meditating under a tree and he's repeating the name of Vishnu, Vishnu, Vishnu. And he says, okay, then when he was passing by, he said, Narada, when you go to Vishnu, can you ask him, when will I get moksha? I said, no problem, I'll check out for you. I'm good at this thing, communicating. He passed by another man, again he was sitting on a tree and meditating and saying, you know, I want to get moksha, Vishnu, etc., repeating the name of Vishnu. And again he asked the same question, when am I going to get moksha? Okay, said Narada, I'll check out with Vishnu. That's good like this, a good communication with Vishnu. So he went to visit Vaikut, and Vishnu is sitting there and said, I've got two questions. These two guys, you know them because you are Vishnu, you know everything. Now, first one is asking, when am I getting moksha? Second is also the same question, what is the answer? So Vishnu gave the answer, and Narada said, fair enough. And he went back down to earth. Of course, he kind of transmigrates quite a lot. He's got a special pass. So he again went to the first man, he was waiting. What did Vishnu say? He said, Vishnu said, you have to continue to worship him for 3 more lifetime before you will achieve moksha. The man was crestfallen. 3 more lifetime is too much. He started to cry. Oh, it's too much. Now I said, well, this answer I got, so be it. I can't do much about it. And he went away. The second man he went. And the second was a bit more jovial, a bit more humorous. I think like us, Padma. So again, the second man asked, when am I getting moksha? And because he was so kind of, you know, looked so frivolous and kind of jovial, etc., the answer Narada gave him was this. He said, look, can you see you're sitting under a tree? Can you count the number of leaves on the tree? You will have to work that many lifetimes before you attain a moksha. You think that man would be crestfallen and weep and cry and break his heart? Nothing doing. He started dancing. Yahoo! That's all. So many leaves. That's not this fun. Yahoo! You see, he saw life as a transition. If you like a scenic route. He was prepared to play along. The moment he started dancing and jumping, was saying, yeah, definitely, I'm going to get moksha, definitely, after so many lives. Narada said, yes, guaranteed. He started dancing, he said, yahoo, I'm definitely going to, you know, end up with this idea of moksha. The moment he said that, Narada said, my boy, you already attained moksha. When you have that attitude, that moksha is guaranteed for me, then you already attained moksha, my friend. That assurance you have, this is the assurance, the guarantee from Hindus. Every living thing is rushing towards moksha. They may take a long time, many lives. What's the rush? As the man said, so many lifetimes I mess around, but I'll find moksha at the end. This is the promise. One thing I must say, you see, we believe in kalpa, cycle of creation and destruction. Somebody asked Ms. Lakhani, suppose the kalpa ends and you don't attain moksha, there are billions of living things, they don't attain moksha, what will happen to them? The answer is this, actually they were never here anyway, didn't I tell you? They just appear to be here dancing around here and the dance stops. They attain moksha anyway.
Wonderful. It's very good. So in the same as in the Jain religion where Lord Mahavira says that you too can attain enlightenment. So each and every person can achieve enlightenment and it's within them. It's within each individual.
Padma, the reason why I like Jainism and Buddhism so much is precisely this. They empower humanity. Not say, sit at my feet, suit you, I'll suit you. They say, stand your feet, you'll sort yourself out.
Yes.
This idea of Buddhism, Jainism, Buddha never said, bow down to me. He said, become a Buddha. Become a Buddha. And my Vivekananda said, don't become Vivekananda, become better than a Vivekananda.
And Jainism also says, preaches exactly the same thing, which is, you know, you...
This is the beauty of the Indic traditions.
Very good. Welcome to Indra Sikandar, Lata Ji, Kavita Revi Devi Rathman, and Sivadas Ji. Welcome. So we'll jump into the next question from Rajiv Bhagat. Jai sir, why the most enlightened souls like Ramakrishna, Sri Ramana Maharishi have to suffer much bodily? Even Swami Vivekananda had many illnesses. So they're going through the physical process of being a mortal before they're reaching enlightenment.
Now, this is very interesting because a lot of people worry. They say these are lovely human beings, lovely, they are God people, God man really. Why do they suffer? People like us, we understand we may have done some mischief so we can pay a price for it and we get thumped here and there. But these people have done no mischief. And by the very likely in the past life, they have not done any mischief. And yet, why do they have, you know, cancer? Both Ramakrishna had cancer, Ramana Maharshi had cancer. And Vivekananda, when he passed, they discovered he had 20 illnesses undiagnosed. He didn't bother, he didn't tell anybody. He had these severe problems, yet he kind of lived his life fully without making a single complaint about his bodily functions. Never. This is why, these are, you see, but Mr. Lakhani, why do they suffer? Let me tell you the answer. They don't suffer. You see, you saw them with cancer. Look. These people are beyond the idea they are the body. It's not just make-believe. They actually don't feel they are the body. They would struggle to get back into the body. So for them, these physical illnesses are not real. I'll give you one interesting example. You see, this Ramakrishna, as I tell you, had a habit of, if you mention, this is the unique feature of this particular God-man. If you mention the word God, religion, spiritual, anything, he goes into deepest meditation, whether he's standing or sitting or whatever, goes in, it's difficult to bring him down. We fight to get out of the ego, he fights to get back in the ego. This was a real story of the person in our lifetime, in our times. So he had difficulty. And while he was like this, is the habit, while he's walking, somebody mentions God, he goes in deep meditation and topples over, he broke his arm. So they put a bandage, and he's wondering about with a bandage. And he was just making, you know, someone, a little devotee came and said, pain. And the devotee said, you don't have pain, do you? And Ramakrishna smiles, you rascal, you caught me out. I'm just making a pretend. Oh, I'm human, I got a pain. I don't feel, there's no such thing. Remember, they don't suffer for it. They are in full flow of the true nature of the spirit. How can they have physical, you know, kind of problems, kind of bothering them? That's what Vivekananda had 20 problems, nobody knew about it. He didn't bother with it either. He just flies through. This is the outer garment. So he just kind of play with it, feed it, etc. But they don't get caught up by it. So they're not real. They don't suffer. Remember, my friend, they don't suffer. Because people say, oh, you see, I went as a little child, my mom used to take me all these, you know, devotional movies or Hindi devotional movies where the devotees suffer. They get leprosy and the mother goes, oh. And I said, I don't want to be a devotee. The poor devotees have to go through hell like this. This is terrible. In reality, a true person established in God experience does not suffer. The beautiful story of Narsingh Mehta, as you may have heard, but never mind, I won't go into that.
Wonderful, thank you very much for that. Chandranshu Tripathi has a question for you. Can you please tell the real difference between soul and spirit? I heard you before, but still find it quite difficult to differentiate between the two.
We all struggle. These are not easy issues to kind of, you know, handle. They are difficult issues to handle. Okay, let's get things kind of into perspective. The word soul that we use in English can be translated into Sanskrit or Hindi as Jivatman. Now, Jivatman has got two words, Jiv and Atman. So what it is saying is, when the spirit or Atman that is underpinning to reality in a way, expresses itself through a particular individual. So it becomes encased in a mind and body frame. When it comes or appears to be encased, be careful, it doesn't get encased in reality, it just appears to be encased in a body and mind frame, we call it Jivatman. Now this Jivatman is, if you like, an appearance of the of Atman, the spirit, as if it has been caught up in a body and mind complex. And that is the difference between Jivatman and the self. I've given a very good metaphor. Please, I'll repeat it. It's very important. A lot of people understand it. When you go to the seaside and the sun is out, look at the sea on the surface of the water. Everywhere where the crest, everywhere is a spark. And the sparks come sparkling. Then the wave goes down, the spark disappears, reappears on another wave. Again, sparkle. That is Jivatman. That sparkle is Jivatman. The sun is Atman, the spirit. It appears to be the crest of everywhere, yet it is never come down to the water. It just appears to be there. So the same thing, the spirit that we talk about, Atman, doesn't actually get caught in the water. It just appears to be playing on the surface of the water. So it gets caught up. When it's caught up, we call it Jivatman. So Jivatman is an appearance. Atman is reality.
Right. That's a very good distinction.
It's a very good example I use again and again.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So welcome to Debashish Mukherjee. Welcome to have you on board. Mohit Gupta ji, welcome. Good to have you on board. So please do not forget to like, share and invite your friends. And also if you're watching on YouTube, then you have access to a multitude of our short clips. But to be informed about them, make sure that you subscribe and you also hit the bell button, please. Okay, so we have a question from Urmila Sharma Valand. Please share your views on stigmas attached to disabilities like wheelchair users or crutches, etc. in our community, as well as Sanatan Dharma and Hinduism. In fact, Hinduism is, or the Asian culture, I should say, is very reluctant to show that they have a disabled person in the family, especially if it's a child.
True. In fact, it's good that we bring this out. You see, we notice this. This is, if you like, one of the drawbacks. And I tell you again, where do I put the blame? On misunderstanding the law of karma. This is where the blame lies. When somebody is disabled, someone's got his arm is not working or blind or whatever, they say he must have done bad things in the past life, yes. Karma. So it's catching up. So he's a secondary person, so we can discard him. In fact, the Indian culture is horrible to say. They'll put him in the back room and hide him. They won't allow him to interact with greater society. I tell you, even more serious issue. If you've got somebody who's mentally unstable, you know, mentally disabled in villages in India, this is reality, it's frightening. They actually abandon the child and throw the child out in the street to fend for itself. They live like animal, eat from the dustbin, die like that. Frightening scenario. And this is still visible in India, huh? I'm very honest. And the reason is why we don't want to take responsibility, mm-hmm. because they must have done bad things in their past life. So let them suffer and die in the dustbin. What a horrible thing. You see, misunderstanding the law of karma is one of the greatest problems of modern India. We like to blame people of other religion for misunderstanding certain serious issues. The Hindus, the worst thing you've done is not understood the law of karma. The law of karma never teaches stuff like that. Things gang up. Millions of things combined together to produce that result of that disabled child. Nothing to do with the child doing bad karma in the past life. Don't you dare say that. Things have ganged up against that individual. It is our job, we see an issue in front of us, to address it and not hide it get a stigma regarding disability. Don't you dare. This is, if you like, because they say, nobody deserves it. Things gang up against us without our, involvement. So be it. Come fighting, says the teaching of Hinduism. Not saying you're hiding or side. And this is why, look, I tell you, even though the British Empire has got a very bloody history, very checkered history, very nasty. They were nasty wherever they went. They slaughtered people, converted them, did horrendous things. You know, since the Second World War, after a lot of bloodshed, shedding a lot of blood and killing a lot of youngsters, they have really matured dramatically. This nation has matured dramatically. So when I praise this country, because why are you praising this Mr. Lakhani, Britain have done so much harm to India, etc., destroyed our industry. I say, I know, the history is very checkered. Well, what they have done in the last 50, 60 after Second World War is incredibly good. Recognize something good. They were given this egalitarian, produce an egalitarian society. In this country, if you are disabled, forget about hiding you. They buy you a little scooter and you overtake everybody else on the pavement. And I said, wow, this is me giving dignity to disabled people, genuinely without giving stigma to them, saying you must have done bad things, so suffer now. No such thing. Must recognize. When we see a flaw in our system, we must recognize it. Others will never overcome it.
Well, the thing is, we don't know how many great scientists or how many people we're missing out on. Look at Stephen Hawking.
Yeah.
I mean, who are we missing out on?
Yeah.
What knowledge, what gift to the world are we missing out on? It's like bringing down the rainforests and saying, oh, we're missing a cure for this disease or that disease, you know? Okay, so Paras Thakur has a question for us. The Vedas and Puran indicate that the universe will die one day. So will we continue to exist after that as souls, perhaps?
It's very good. I just actually addressed this question, but let me touch on it again.
Very slightly, because we are being inundated with questions. We have about
quickly,
three
very
pages.
Sharp. We believe in the kulp idea of cycle of creation and destruction. At the end of a kulp, when the whole thing gets crunched up, we agree with most modern cosmology about the idea of creation and destruction. It's called kalpa. What happens to all these souls who have not achieved moksha? Didn't I tell you they were never here? So there's no issue of them getting moksha. They were never here. They appear to have been here, and that appearance stops. That's all.
Very good.
Short answer.
Thank you very much, because we have a page and a half of questions that we must get through today.
Okay.
And we're running short on time. So we have a question from Uma Velu. The kids often ask, why do we have to read the Gita, Ramayana, etc.? They are not interested. How can we answer this in a positive way?
Good. You see, if you try and kind of impose your own particular vision of religion onto your youngster, it's not going to work anymore. It's finished. The days are gone. When I was little, when my daughter was little, I used to do stories of Ramayana and all these colorful marriage. They used to dance about. Now they say we prefer Star Wars, X-Men, and Superman. So mythology has to move, has to evolve. The ancient mythology is no longer palatable by modern youngsters in the world, the whole world. They prefer modern technological mythology, you know, all these colorful technological weapons and so. Allow for it. This is again the same idea of courage and valor and standing up for your rights, etc., presented in modern mythology, and recognize it and play with it. Don't get frightened by it. So you must keep moving on. So idea is, be ready to evolve with the times and don't get frightened that, oh, they don't subscribe to Ramayana, that means they're lost. They're not lost. They're going to rediscover the ideas behind Ramayana in modern mythology. So be it.
Okay. So welcome to Ukar Sharma and to Sridharan Ramanazan. We have five more questions I'd like you to get through. Sarbjit Roy, would you throw some light on Narasimha the avatar? It's like nature of reality, like quantum, not here. Not there, not day, not night, not inside, not outside.
It's just a colorful story. Look, Narasimha avatar, people sometimes hate me for saying things like that. Look, it's in the Puranic story. Puran means legendary story. I ask people, have you discovered any skeleton with half man, half lion, or half, you know, animal, etc.? They say none. So how can I subscribe to such ideas? So these are, I feel like, colorful narratives. If you recognize that the such and then live with it, look, we use narratives. In science, I say we're using narrative. So use narrative to come to terms with subtle ideas, but don't think it's literally true. Then this question doesn't arise. It's nothing to do with quantum physics, my friend.
Thank you. And Gunu Ratnam has a question. I read about Mahavatar Babaji from Himalayas. Some texts consider him as an immortal guru. Can you explain about this information?
Okay, look, we are spoiled for choice, I'll be very honest. Even though I am personally kind of strongly attached, you know, attracted to Ramakrishna Vivekananda, these are not the only, they have no monopoly. We continue to produce, not only within our tradition, with other traditions also, great spiritual giants. Every tradition, every age will produce spiritual giants throughout the world. We are open to that idea. We don't say we have monopoly. So I've heard about this name. I heard about lots of other names as well. And I actually like a lot of these personalities. When I look at their lives, I don't know what I like. They're not out for money, for commercial purposes. They're not out for name or fame. They're not out doing commercial thing under the name of religion. So these are genuine spiritual masters. And there are so many, and I've not explored all of them, including this particular gentleman, so I can't comment, but I'm open to the idea there are many wonderful personalities that India has produced over many thousands of years.
Okay. We have a couple of questions here, but they're very practical questions, sort of things like, I don't have a name for this person, but can a divorced couple perform Ganeshan Mandap Puja and Havan Puja for their son's wedding at their home?
Okay, good. Always ask such questions. Liturgy, when you say, okay, is it written in the Shastras, means ancient textbooks where they give you a prescription of how to carry out certain rituals, they are called Shastras. Answer is no. Shastras come with a sell-by date. It may have suited a particular age in the history of Hinduism, but it is not necessarily suitable now. So you must think for yourself. The idea is think for yourself and decide. Why should it be inauspicious for you to carry out any religious ceremony because you know if your issue of marriage, etc., should not get in the way whatsoever. One other lady asked me, they said, Ms. Lakhani, why are widows inauspicious? I said, what a horrible idea. Why should widows be inauspicious? They are as auspicious as widows. You know, why widowers? Throw the widows. So if you want to make widows...
Oh, satipayas.
Yeah, sati, plug them in. So please be aware that we are an evolving religion. In certain age, we produce all these shastras, and I am fed up with these shastras. They come with such horrible prescription, they are no longer suited for the age that we live in. So please move away. Create your own shastra. That's my teaching.
The second portion to that question is, when a woman divorces, can she still continue to perform Guru Devi Puja? And so the answer is, yes, you can. And then if no, why not? And then can you bring some light about discrimination against divorced women and widows? So this question has also been answered. The sad thing is that men have discriminated against women. So you have answered your own question, sir, for thousands of years. But what's alarming is that so many more married Hindu women do discriminate against women who fall into that category. It's the catch, isn't it? It's a society catch.
Social.
It's a social designation that, oh, if I don't do that, then, you know, this is what will happen. We have 1, 2, 3. Do we have time to get through 3 more?
5 minutes.
Okay. So we're running very short on time. So welcome to John Karki, Linda Estrell. Very nice to have you on board. Okay, questions. Why only Hindus are attacked in India than any other religions? And if one has proudly saying, I am a Hindu, what are the core qualities he, she must have? How immediately can one be assessed? He's a Hindu. I don't know if I like the last bit of the question where it says, you know, how immediately one can be assessed.
You get a rubber stamp.
I have to start looking over my body to say if I'm qualified as a Hindu or am I rubber stamped as a Hindu somewhere.
Let me take the first part of the question. Why are Hindus under attack in India? Why are you said to say, proudly say, I'm a Hindu? Why? Again, please bear with me. I have to put the blame after independence. We lost track of our backbone, our main theme. Our main theme of this nation has always been spiritual, and we decided to ignore it and kind of in a way adopt a very half-baked secular model. Now, the way we did this is came in the constitution. Somehow they felt Hinduism is a curse on India. So the constitution said, avoid the word Hindu, take Hinduism out of the system. That's what they did in the constitution. That's why I can't teach Hinduism in this Indian school now. So in the constitution, they somehow felt, this is we are so weak. We are made to feel that Hinduism is a weakness. So pull out of the constitution. And this is why we sit. At the moment, Narendra Modi cannot not reintroduce certain ideas which are saying teach Hinduism in the school simply because he has to fight the constitution. He requires 2/3 majority and he struggles. So it is the why? Because we, you know, so clever. We don't need Hinduism. It's a curse on India. The outdated stuff and satis and all these gods and goddesses. So pull it out. By doing that, we pulled out the backbone of that nation. That is why at the moment, many Hindus are frightened to even declare they are Hindus. They think, oh, this is a negative thing. It's a weakness in my system. It's not a weakness. It's the very strength of your being. So please assert fully that your background is spiritual. That's what it means, saying I'm a Hindu. How do you know you're a Hindu? If you like the ideas that are coming out in the name of contemporary, modern, rational vision of Hinduism, if you subscribe to those ideas, you are a Hindu. We are not going to send you from London, rubber stamp from London, on your bottom, say, plug it on. Just show your bottom. Ah, I've got to be a Hindu now. You are a Hindu. If you subscribe to the ideas of promoting and projecting in the WhatsApp, etc., you're already a Hindu, my friend. You don't need any other accreditation.
Thank you very much for that very important question, Satish Shindeji. Umesh Prasad, welcome. And please do try to join us a little earlier. Okay, so we have a question here. Hi, can we...
Okay, this is from Germany, Dominic from Germany. Dominic is saying, life is so painful. I just quickly picked up the basic of the question. He said, life is so painful. So if I'm Brahman, why bother with anything? That's what he's saying. He's kind of very despondent regarding life. He's saying, if you're Brahman and all the life is painful, etc., why not fling this life away? No. The thing is this. This life that you're stuck with is sticking to you like a chewing gum that doesn't. It's difficult to pull out. So it's going to, even if you try and run away from it, it's going to keep pulling you back. So the way to resolve your human condition is not to run away. It is to recognize that life is going to be tough and I need to rise above it rather than kind of run away from it. Running away from these issues will not solve your problem. You are going to be stuck and be reborn again and again, go in nappies and go through the whole process again and again. And until you say, look, I must rise above, I'm going to roll up my sleeves. This is getting out of hand now. I want to rise above it. So you don't become despondent and run away from life because you say, just somebody told you you're Brahman. You basically say, if I'm Brahman, I want to experience it. Then I don't get worried. And I tell you the real truth. So many powerful personalities we produce throughout the world who actually experience this. And you see their lives transported. It's not some morbid kind of, you know, snuffing out process. It is a full life-giving process, embracing life fully, living more intensely than you can ever imagine. There is a destination. So don't run away. You've got a real prize to still capture. And when you capture it, you know what I'm talking about.
I think so. I think just a very quick touch on this one, because that leads very nicely onto that last question. This will be our last question for today. So friends, please do like, share, comment. And if you're watching on YouTube, do hit the bell button and to subscribe to us. So this is a question from Devashish Mukherjee. How to cleanse your mind and get away from unwanted thoughts? I'm trying sadhana yet finding it difficult to.
You see, so, this is a very nice question to finish with today. The mind is like a sponge. You may think, no, it's under my control. A sponge is not under your control. It goes anywhere that's wet, it'll just pull anything out. Any wet stuff, it'll just suck it in. It's not under your control. Mind is exactly like that. It is, even though we think it's under our control, it's not under our control. So whatever you expose your mind to, it is going to absorb. Because I know people who watch these horrible movies, etc., you know, kind of soap operas, etc., with such rubbish being, you know, kind of dished out, and they sit in front of it, and I say, look, whether you like it or you're going to absorb, it's going to enter your system and disturb you, create, if you like, a mess in your system. So don't expose yourself to such material. And we are very good at this emotive material. We like to wallow in sentimentality, soap operas and Hindi films. And then we kind of wallow in this, and all these ideas are going to kind of latch on to you and in a way disturb you and won't give you peace, guaranteed. So first thing is avoid things which are kind of dangerous, because you think, no, I'm strong, I can, you know, stand aside from you. You can't. Anything you touch, this like mind is a sponge. It'll pull things that from you which you didn't even expect is already in your system. One. Second, these are the lovely things that came from my mentor. He said, if you are a worldly person, living in a worldly life, sorry, I don't say worldly person, living in a worldly life, two things you do to cleanse your mind. First, interesting thing is, he said, go into solitude once in a while, once in a, every 3 months, 6 months, 1 month, 1 year, go into solitude for a few days and take stock of your life. That particular process of saying, look, what have I achieved in the whole year? Have I become more kind of jittery? Have I become more frenzied? Have I become more calm? What have I achieved? What have I not achieved? What has stopped me from achieving? Take stock of your life, a spiritual stock of it, a spiritual balance sheet. Look at it. Plus liability or asset or liability. Check it out. First thing. The second beautiful thing he said, suggests is this. Just as bad, you know, influences can easily enter your system, good influences can also be absorbed by the mind. So the lovely word, the Sanskrit word is satsang. Always mix with people with high aspirations. Never mix with people with low aspiration. Look, I'll tell you London scene. If you go to any of these parties, they're all holding, you know, a glass of wine and doing small talk. They don't mean anything. They say, I haven't seen you for a long time. Why don't you pop in? Oh, they don't get pop in at all. Just talks, rubbish, small talk. Oh, I went to that restaurant, the powder, the chili was so nice. And I went here on a holiday and, said 5-star. The talk is so kind of trivial and so superficial, it will really kind of reduce your level. So always mix in a company that will take you to higher ideals, higher principles, not this kind of superficial element. We are all get caught up with this. It's a rise above it. So again, the company you keep is the best way to cleanse your mind. Choose your company very carefully. People who think of higher things, catch hold of them and don't let them go. They are your, if like your MasterCard, your trump card, to rise above this worldly life that we lead. I think we should finish with this.
I think so. I think that's a lovely note to finish on, because any business that has run deficiently does stock take every now and then. And so we should do that with our lives too. So I hope to see you all next week, and look forward to seeing you all. And please don't forget to like, share and subscribe, and do join us again at 1 o'clock next Saturday.
Can I just say, Padma has been a major kind of very good presenter, and we missed her the last few weeks for whatever reason. She's not telling us the reasons. And Nishit Bhai to step in and did a fantastic job as well. And he's sitting in the background here.
I'm very grateful. If he wasn't here, then I wouldn't have been able to take the necessary break that I needed.
We've got a lovely team, very lovely team, working together and hopefully doing something positive for greater world.
We're only here because you are here.
Thank you, Padma.
Thank you.